Jupiter and Mars and all gods that raised the Roman Empire to ruler of the world, I invoke you and I pray, guard this prosperity, this peace, now and into the future.
In the year 14, prayers such as these were heard around the vast dominion ruled by Rome. For in that year, the empire stood at a precipice. The Emperor Augustus had died. Augustus had been a towering figure. He had extinguished a century of civil war. He presided over 40 years of internal peace and prosperity. He forged the vision and power that cemented the empire together. But the peace of Augustus came at a price. By the end of his life, Augustus had eclipsed the Senate, ruled as a monarch, and founded a dynasty that was fraught with troubles. His heirs, Tiberius, Caligula, Claudius, these men would lead Rome through years of political terror, imperial madness, assassination, and through the distant founding of a new religion that would one day engulf the empire itself. The years to come would be years of trial, testing the endurance of subjects and citizens, soldiers and slaves, the men and women of the Roman Empire in the first century.
We can now sail to Spain in just 4 days, Gaul in 3 days, and we can reach Africa on the gentlest breeze overnight.
As the first century unfolded, ancient observers were awestruck by their shrinking world.
Incredibly, even Egypt is barely 7 days' journey.
For the empire that Augustus left behind, was now more than a collection of conquered lands. It was a far-flung society of vibrant commerce and frequent travel. By the year 14, the people of modern-day France, Turkey, Syria, Greece, Spain, and North Africa were all part of Rome. They contributed to its wealth and gained from its protection. But at Augustus's death, the family of Rome also included some troubling members. Egypt, conquered some 45 years earlier, remained an exotic land of disturbing power. Judea, added to a half century before, was a tinderbox. And in Germany, local tribes resisted full subjugation. Then there was Britain. Once Julius Caesar had proudly claimed the island for Rome. But his claim did not hold, and at Augustus's death, Britain still lay tantalizingly beyond grasp. As he lay dying, Augustus assumed a philosophical air. "Did I play my part well in this comedy of life?" he asked. The answer was a resounding yes. The Senate declared Augustus a god, and as he passed into legend, he passed the torch of leadership to a man who had stood in the shadows for 50 years, his grown stepson, Tiberius. The years of waiting had come with wrenching sacrifice. Once Tiberius had been happily married, but he had been forced to divorce his wife and marry the emperor's daughter. Tiberius complied with Augustus's order, but his biographer reports that he was never the same.
Tiberius had loved his wife. After the divorce, he grieved that he had pushed her away and had great anguish in his soul. The one time he caught sight of her, He watched her with such strained and swollen eyes that an officer was assigned to keep her from his presence.
Despite his sacrifice, Tiberius had been spurned. Augustus only chose him after more favored heirs had died. And still, Tiberius's position was insecure, for the Senate was leery. Its members needed leadership, but hated monarchy, and many resented the turn to hereditary rule.
Tiberius was in an impossible situation. He did not expect to become emperor originally. He was not Augustus's first choice. He was not Augustus. He had not accomplished what Augustus had. So the negotiation of his role with regard to those who were his social peers was very difficult indeed.
The Senate chamber was tense as Augustus's will was read. Tiberius moved warily to claim his legacy, and he gave confusing signals. Would Tiberius assume full imperial powers, the senators asked? No, he responded. Which branch of government will you direct? One member called out. Tiberius was silent. How long will Rome remain headless? Shouted another.
Tiberius wanted power, all right. The excuse for behaving in the way he does is that that's how Augustus himself had done it. He's trying to be a good Augustus lookalike. Augustus came to power by refusing it. He feels he too must refuse. But somehow, subtly, oddly, he got the game wrong. He refused too much. He didn't convince anyone that his refusal was genuine, and he only caused resentment.
As Tiberius groped awkwardly to define his role, events outside Rome turned ominous. A message arrived from the provinces. Two armies on the northern frontier were refusing orders. It started among the legions in modern-day Hungary and Austria, just 10 days' march from Rome. One disgruntled soldier voiced the bitter realities of army life, and mounting a rostrum made of dirt, he stoked the fires of resentment.
Old men are enduring 30 and 40 years of service. Many have even lost limbs. And discharge does not end it. They do the same work by a different name. And if by some chance one survives, he is dragged to the ends of the earth and given payment with a swampy marsh or sterile mountainside. By Hercules, life in the legions is brutal and unprofitable.
Gradually, the arguments struck home. Soldiers began showing their scars. Some looted. Officers were killed. And with words of defiance ringing in the air, mutiny gained momentum.
Why should you obey like slaves? When will you dare demand payback if not with a new and wavering emperor?
It was Rome's worst nightmare, and it demanded attention from the imperial family. With the new emperor busy in Rome, another family member was sent to quell the rebellion. He was called Germanicus. He was young, charismatic, and loved by the soldiers as a man of the legions. His wife had even given birth in an army outpost, and the couple's two-year-old son wore a tiny army uniform. Bootsy, the soldiers called him. In Latin, Caligula. The child was the darling of the Roman legions, their imperial mascot. When Germanicus and his family reached the mutinous camp, it was clear that more violence loomed. Their very lives were at risk. Germanicus consulted his advisors. He tearfully urged his wife to seek refuge with a nearby tribe. She agreed, leaving with little Caligula in her arms. Some years later, the historian Tacitus recorded the scene.
A wretched group of women marched away. The commander's wife, a refugee, clutching her small son to her breast, surrounded by the weeping wives of his comrades. The wailing was noticed by the soldiers who came out of their tents. They felt shame and pity and thought of her forefathers and of her son, a child born and raised among the tents. They begged, they insisted that she come back.
Rebel unity was broken. Germanicus became a hero, and Caligula and his mother returned to camp.
Caligula, as a child in the middle of this mutiny, must have seen the importance of the loyalty of the army. And in fact, he had been the darling of the soldiers, and he could appreciate the loyalty that the army felt to the imperial family in Rome. And yet he also could see what would happen if the soldiers' expectations weren't met. They were not going to maintain the loyalty.
Army loyalty, Caligula saw, was the core of imperial strength. But events would offer Caligula another darker lesson. Popularity could be a dangerous thing. Just 5 years later, Caligula's father Germanicus lay dying, poisoned, it was believed, on orders from the emperor. Tiberius insisted he played no part in the death of Germanicus, but neither did he mourn, for he well knew that public favorites could be as threatening as army mutinies, and survival demanded brutal vigilance. Governing Rome, Tiberius mused, was like holding a wolf by the ears. That reality would stalk the imperial family for generations to come.
I must go and have a bath. Yes, it's time. I get myself some towels, I run and catch up with the others, and I say to one and all, how are you? Have a good bath. Have a good supper.
Young and old, rich and poor, men and women, every day in mid-afternoon, countless people around the empire ended their work and made their way to the baths.
Labor and worry be gone. I sing the baths, bejeweled with shining tiles.
Most bath complexes were large, congenial places where all classes mingled in one of the great unifying rituals of Roman life. They included outdoor areas for exercise, food stands for snacks, and noisy attendants who offered every sort of service.
I would die if silence were as necessary to study as they say. I live just above the bathhouse.
The philosopher Seneca found his local bath a mixed blessing.
Consider all the hateful voices I hear. When the brawny men exercise with their lead weights, I hear their groans and gasps. Or when someone else comes in to get a vulgar massage, I hear the slap of a hand on the shoulders. Add those who leap into the pool with a huge splash. And besides these, who at least have normal voices, consider the hair plucker, always screeching for customers and never quiet, except when he's making someone else cry.
After several hours in the boisterous atmosphere, wealthy Romans headed home for an evening with friends. The less privileged met at roadside cafes. But one and all, Romans cherished their late afternoon rituals as staples of life.
Baths, wine, and sex ruin our bodies. But what makes life worth living except sex, wine, and baths?
Away from the public eye, Augustus's first successor lived in gloom. The emperor Tiberius was already 55 when he inherited Rome from his stepfather, and he was a dour, cynical man. Embittered by his years of obscurity, Tiberius now resented the courtiers who once scorned him. He despised their intrigues and obsequious manners. Men fit to be slaves, he muttered as he left the Senate House. Many senators thought little better of Tiberius. They grew to hate him for his cryptic wishes and his unpredictable moods.
What really gets up their noses is that he both demands civility from them and then pretends to be treating them like equals and saying, oh, no, no, don't be servile, don't flatter me. I don't want this adulation that you offer me. And yet it was clear to them that unless he was flattered, unless they behaved like slaves, he wasn't actually happy. That's why they called him a hypocrite.
With mutual contempt between senators and Tiberius, the emperor sought counsel outside their ranks in a cavalry officer named Sejanus, a man the ancient historian Tacitus called a small town cheater.
Sejanus was brazen, with great physical endurance. Outwardly, he appeared honorable, but inside, he nursed a greedy nature.
You have to remember that the Romans could be extraordinarily snobbish. The Romans weren't against social mobility, absolutely, but they hated to see upstarts who they see as getting into power not because they're good, but because they cheat the system, because they worm their way into the favor of the emperors, and they cheat themselves into social standing.
Tiberius gave Sejanus command of the Praetorian Guard, an elite battalion created to keep order and protect the emperor. Sejanus concentrated his troops in a single camp, billeted in one place, Tacitus says. The guard enhanced Sejanus' political influence.
When the camp was finished, he insinuated himself into the soldiers' affections, speaking to each man to man. He chose their leaders himself. And to senators, he hinted at offices and provincial posts for those who supported him.
Tiberius offered his aide the highest honors. He openly praised Sejanus, calling him the partner of my labors, and Sejanus reveled in the emperor's trust. He would use it to clear a path for his own power and subject Rome to a reign of terror reminiscent of its darkest past. Germanicus, the hero of the army mutiny, was dead. Now, Sejanus warned, the dead man's family was plotting to seize power. Germanicus's widow was parted from her children and sent into exile. In Rome, young Caligula was spared abuse, but his older brothers were less fortunate. Suetonius describes their fate.
Both were judged to be traitors and sentenced to death. One in the basement of the imperial palace, where starvation drove him to eat the stuffing from his pillow. It is believed that the other committed suicide when an executioner came and showed him a noose and the hooks for dragging his corpse through the city. Their ravaged remains were so scattered that it was very difficult to collect them.
This is what's wrong with the system that Augustus established. It's a system that's only as strong as the male member of the family who comes to power is, emotionally and physically. And while there were some very impressive people, most notably Augustus, who assumed this role, there were others who had a great deal wrong with them. And a lot of what was wrong with them was merely living in this household where people are constantly vying for power and favor.
The emperor's aide, Sejanus, soon widened his purge. He launched treason trials. Rivals were routinely convicted and, according to Tacitus, executed.
It was a time of corruption, greed, and subservience. Not only the elite felt insecure in their positions, but even lower-ranked officials competed to perform foul and slavish acts.
Barely a decade after Augustus had died, the dynasty he founded was failing Rome. The now elderly Tiberius would not, or could not, stop the purge.
Where was Tiberius when the trials and other atrocities and persecutions were going on towards the end of his reign? It's difficult to tell. He had withdrawn from the city because he was tired of the capital and its politics. He may have known of some of the trials that were going on. He may not. He may have simply been duped. How do we know? It's very difficult to tell.
In the year 26, disgusted and insecure, Tiberius had turned his back on Rome and retreated to the island of Capri, an isolated refuge that offered security from his enemies and diversions for his troubled mind.
Once retired to Capri, he set up rooms for his depraved urges.
Perched in one of 12 clifftop villas, Tiberius sought release in astrology, in wine, and according to his gossipy biographer Suetonius, in all manner of self-indulgence.
He procured groups of girls and boys known for their sexual inventions. They enacted their unique depravities before him to arouse his failing sex drive. He decorated the bedrooms with erotic paintings, figurines, and Egyptian pornography. So they knew the work they were expected to put out.
Only Sejanus had regular access to the reclusive emperor. And after Tiberius's own son died, only Sejanus enjoyed the emperor's trust. In Rome, he assumed all the powers of his absent patron and ruled with growing autonomy. Sejanus, it seemed, was poised to displace Tiberius himself.
Sejanus had clearly been plotting to secure the emperorship for himself. There's no doubt about that, and he had waged campaigns against members of the imperial family. It's very difficult to know what caused his undoing in the end, because we don't have a complete account.
In the year 31, events took a surprising turn. Tiberius suddenly soured on Sejanus and suddenly embraced Caligula, the only surviving son of his imperial family. Tiberius called Caligula to Capri. Then he sent a secret message to the Senate condemning Sejanus. The ancient historian Cassius Dio tells the story as it was recounted to him.
At sunrise, the emperor's agent climbed the hill where the Senate was convening in the Temple of Apollo. He found Sejanus outside. He consoled him with lies, telling him that he was about to be named next in line. Ecstatic, Sejanus ran into the building.
As the emperor's agent slipped away, Tiberius's letter was read aloud. Line by line, it condemned Sejanus. Slowly, senators inched away.
The presiding officer called Sejanus forward, but he did not obey because he had never taken orders. He was called a second and third time. Then the officer said, "Sejanus, come here." Sejanus answered blankly, "Are you calling me?" He whom they once worshipped, they now led to execution.
Sejanus was strangled. His body was dumped into the river Tiber. In an age of emperors, violence was the only recourse for the aggrieved, and brutality always lurked near the surface.
What we might understand from Sejanus's downfall is that no one was secure within the court system. This was a secretive form of government. Power was pursued by those who were unscrupulous and wanted to wield it, but no one could be secure in his control of power. The emperor could strike down anyone at a moment's notice.
Still in Capri, Tiberius continued the business of government. His rivals had all been destroyed, but so had the chance of stable succession. As Tiberius entered his last years, weary and remote, his only surviving heir, was Caligula.
To the official in charge of revenues, it is now nearly 2 years ago that Apollonius made off with my dowry, and he left me with the female child, which we conceived together, in rags.
Although emperors often struck down their political enemies, millions of anonymous people around the empire led less eventful lives. They paid taxes, struggled to support their families, and when problems arose, they appealed to Roman administrators for relief.